Welcome, everyone. My name is Grzegorz Ekiert. I'm a director of the Center for European Studies and professor of government. And it is my great pleasure to welcome all of you to this very special event. This is Summit on the Future of Europe 2015. This is the key event in our fall semester. And the idea of the summit is to focus on the most important challenges faced by Europe. And we want to have a conversation between academics and policymakers, as well as between Europeans and American scholars. So that's a very different event from most of the purely academic events we are organizing at the Center for European Studies. When we were planning that event back in May and April, you know, the big crisis in Europe was sort of simmering in the sort of usual steady way. So the euro crisis and economic crisis in many European countries were still far away from a resolution. The Russian annexation of Ukraine and of Crimea and the aggression on eastern Ukraine that produced the most dramatic geopolitical challenge in Europe after the Second World War was still not over. And the legitimacy of European institutions was still declining. I would like to just remind you that European Parliament has the biggest anti-systemic opposition among all the parliaments in Europe. 25% of the members of European Parliament are working actively on rolling back European integration. So we were sort of thinking about all those issues. Since our previous summit was devoted to euro crisis and crisis in Ukraine, we decided to think about the southern flank of Europe and focus both on southern European countries suffering from various kinds of austerity policies, as well as about southern European neighborhood, where wars and civil wars have been taking place over the last several years. We did not really anticipate the final crisis unfolding in front of our eyes at this moment, namely the refugee crisis, which turned from a trickle of problems to real disaster. And I think that this is something which we are going to face, and Europe is going to face, first of all, for many months, if not years, to come. Now, I think that none of the problems of Europe has been resolved at this point. We had this wonderful panel of top economists at the Center for European Studies this morning. They told us that there is no light in the end of the tunnel when it comes to stability of the Eurozone and economic growth in Europe. Legitimacy crisis of the European Union is moving with increasing speed. The trust in European institutions is declining and reached the level we never seen before, especially in Eastern Europe. Economic sanctions on Russia has been just extended for another half a year, and people are still dying in Donbas. Greece has the same prime minister and is under much tougher adjustment and austerity program than it was half a year ago, and we can easily say that the refugee crisis is about to begin, not end in Europe. Now, this gives us plenty of things to discuss and think about. Now, we begin tonight with the keynote address, and then we continue tomorrow for the entire day. And I hope that you will all participate in the events of the summer. Now, before we introduce our tonight's speaker, let me extend some thank you to several people. First of all, I would like to thank you, the staff of the Center for European Studies, and especially our director, Elaine Papoulias. This has been a very difficult event to organize. Guests we invited, like EU Commissioner on migration policies, of course, had to cancel since they sit in constant meeting 24 hours a day, and this was several cases of that kind happened during the last few days of organizing the summit. So it was a great effort on part of our staff to cope with this. Now, I would like to say that this event would have never been organized without the generous support and help of the Center for International Relations and Sustainable Development, headed by Vuk Jeremić. Now, Vuk Jeremić participated already in our previous panel last year, which was supported by Berggruen Institute, and has been a friend of the Center for many years. He is not only the president of the Center for International Relations and Sustainable Development, but also editor-in-chief of the Horizons, which is a prominent public policy journal. In 2012, Vuk was elected by the majority of nations to be the president of the 67th session of the United Nations General Assembly, and under his aegis, the assembly discussed a number of critical issues and focused on a number of critical policies. Vuk Jeremić served as the Serbia's Minister of Foreign Affairs from 2007 to 2012, and he's been active in lecturing and in participation in public debates and so on. Vuk Jeremić was educated in two small cities called Cambridge. So his BA degree is from Cambridge University, and his MA degree in public administration is from Harvard Kennedy School. Thank you, Vuk, for supporting this big event, and I ask Vuk to come to the stage to introduce our keynote speaker today, Professor Gikas Hardouvelis.
Thank you very much, Grzegorz, for this most kind introduction. It's an exceptional pleasure and honor to be back at Harvard to be working with the Center for European Studies. It's an enormous privilege to partner up with the Center for European Studies for organizing the summit on the future of Europe. Indeed, I was here last year, and we discussed the European crisis, and we were making projections with regard to how things are going to unfold, and we didn't really were on spot with our predictions, which means that European situation is pretty much still in flux. But a few words about the center. Center for International Relations and Sustainable Development is a pretty young organization. We've been in existence for only about a year and a half. We're headquartered in Belgrade, but we do most of our activities all over the world. It was brought into existence with a great help from some of my friends and former colleagues, some of which are here in the audience, including my teacher, my Harvard professor and mentor, Jeffrey Sachs, who's not with us this afternoon. But in about a year and a half, we have grown into an organization that is privileged to be able to organize conferences like this in America, but also in Africa, Asia, in Europe. There is also this journal that we are producing, Horizons, the latest issue. I think there are going to be some copies available throughout the conference. And part of it, part of the latest issue of Horizons, is on the future of Europe in the context of the world in flux. So Grzegorz really went into discussion of where Europe is going and what kind of crisis we are facing today, so I'm not going to dwell on for too long on it. But basically, the European borders are in flames, the ones to the east and the ones to the southeast. And what we are witnessing right now, which he called a refugee crisis, is perhaps only a beginning of the European continent starting to feel the consequences of the tectonic shifts that are happening in its neighborhood. And it's not only Russia, and it's not only the Middle East. I think it's the whole world that now influences what is happening in Europe. And what is happening in Europe between the European leaders in particular is that Europe is increasingly focused on itself, on its internal crisis. And I believe that this is going to be tonight a discussion on one of the arch crises that are of inner nature to the European Union, the one that shook the whole continent and the whole world, international financial markets as well, that had at the epicenter a country that is very dear to me, which I very often call my second homeland, that is Greece. That's a place where my family used to live for so many years. Thanks to Greek generosity, I was educated here at Harvard. Kokkalis Foundation. I was a Kokkalis scholar at the Kennedy School of Government. That's when I met the engine behind this conference and my longstanding friend, Elin Papoulias. I want to acknowledge her enormously hard work, as well as the hard work of all the others in the Center for European Studies for putting this together. But the summer was a summer of drama, chaos, catastrophe, all Greek words in the English language. And after much drama, we again have an old new government in Greece as of a couple of days ago. I believe this is the third time that this political force comes out victorious at the ballot box this year. Every single time, with strangely enough, with a different set of promises. That is fascinating, especially for those who don't understand Greece. I hope to be able to have a better than average understanding of Greece. And what was always fascinating for me when it comes to Greek politics is that it's not always so much important what you propose, it's how you propose. And I remember that in 1981, when Andreas Papandreou was elected Prime Minister of Greece, he campaigned feverishly on bringing Greece out of Europe and out of NATO. And he won an overwhelming victory. And then he didn't end up bringing Greece out of NATO and out of the European Union. And then upon being asked, Mr. Prime Minister, but what about your main promise? He said, yes, so what? So they said, oh, what's your promise to take Greece outside Euro and outside Europe and outside NATO? And he said, yes, exactly, and that's why they voted for me. And they never expected me to do it afterwards. He then won re-election with an even bigger majority. So things are not always so straightforward in the Balkans and in Greece in particular. But without too much further ado, allow me to introduce our distinguished keynote speaker for this evening. Professor Gikas Hardouvelis is currently Professor of Finance and Economics at the Department of Banking and Financial Management at the School of Finance and Statistics at the University of Piraeus, Greece. He held a number of important posts in Greek administrations. Most recently, he was a Minister of Finance of the Hellenic Republic. Before this year, before the changes that took place in January 2015, he was succeeded by a guy who most people remember, Yanis Varoufakis. So this was a pre-Varoufakis phase that we are talking about. But he did not only serve in that government, he served in other administrations in the position of the director of economics office of two Greek prime ministers, Lukas Papademos and Kostas Tsimitis. Prior to his work in government, he served as the chief economist of the Eurobank group, and he was teaching in various universities. His most distinguished academic career includes teaching at Columbia as well as Rutgers universities. He was one of the founders of the Athens Derivatives Exchange. And prior to going back to his country, he did his PhD degree in economics. In 1983, he graduated from the University of California at Berkeley. And he holds master's and bachelor's degrees in applied mathematics from Harvard University. Professor Gikas Hardouvelis, thank you so much for joining us this evening, and the floor is yours.
Well, thank you, President Jeremić. Thank you, Professor Ekiert, Professor Coates. I'm very happy to be here at the Center of European Studies. I guess the guy that started the center was actually my professor. He passed away, I heard, a couple of weeks ago. I took one government course as a freshman just to test it out before I turned into math. but I still remember him. Anyway, my presentation today, the title is European Monetary Union and Greece. And I want to concentrate on two main questions. The first question is more general, and it's in the minds of everybody. Everybody discusses it. Will the euro area survive the next economic crisis? And the second question is more related to my home country, and is, will Greece be a member of the euro area over the next decade? The two questions are intimately related. Some claim that if Greece were forced to abandon the monetary union, then the irreversibility principle of building EMU would be broken. And this would trigger the future unraveling of the monetary union. Because in the next crisis, the markets would naturally ask who is next. And they're going to pick on the most vulnerable member and attack it. Attack its stock market, stop lending it, in a sense, force it into a corner, force it to abandon the monetary union. So there's that view. But there is another view that says, and people insist on it, especially the hardliners in Europe, that says that you cannot have a stable EMU without incorporating into its bylaws the risk of departure. The fear of departure would incentivize renegade members to behave constructively and avoid exit. Without such a fear, the case of Greece will soon find copycats. For example, some countries would never reform or would never obey the deficit limits of the Stability and Growth Pact. The Greek drama and this particular question was actually played out over the last 8 months. And the far-left Greek party of Syriza behaved as if Europe was scared of the country's possible departure for EMU and would thus bend on its demands. Syriza failed, as you all know, but it nevertheless taught the rest of Europe a very important lesson. The monetary union should not again be in a position of being blackmailed by one of its members who does not wish to obey the rules of EMU. So in my view, if you ask me, the risk of exit may soon, we may see it soon being incorporated into the architecture of EMU. So let me, I told you there are two questions. I'll start with a general one. The first question, the viability of EMU. I tend to have an optimistic view. And I tend to think that the euro area will survive. Now, this is not the average perspective I feel in the US. I remember back in the 1980s, when the discussion of the creation of EMU was picking up momentum, in many academic conferences I went to, in many academic seminars, remember I used to be a pure economist back then, my friends, especially historians, economists, would say the EMU would never happen. Then I also remember 10 years later, I already had gone to Greece, I had been involved in politics and the ECB and all that, and I would come back in the States in similar conferences, and the same people would tell me, very soon the EMU will dissolve. Well, it hasn't dissolved yet, maybe it will not. Now, why do especially American economists think the EMU is doomed? Well, that's because they believe the monetary union is not an optimum currency area. The straitjacket of a common monetary policy inside the union creates enormous pressures on individual countries when those countries are hit by asymmetric shocks but are not united in any other ways. For the monetary union to work properly, the countries ought to have open borders, like free mobility of goods, capital, and labor, a unified financial system, plus they need a fiscal transfer mechanism like it exists in the United States to counteract different calamities that hit certain countries but not other countries. A lot of these elements were missing from the EMU. A lot of these elements are being built up now. In the 1990s, Europeans ignored the economic arguments that it was premature to create a monetary union before their economies united more tightly. They believed the monetary union would force a faster unification in labor markets, in banking services, in fiscal policies, and in politics. They saw the monetary union as a catalyst for the desired economic and political unification, not as a source of frictions. And the markets back then were enthusiastic about the monetary union. In order to join the EMU, remember, the countries had to reduce their fiscal deficits and they had to reduce inflation. Hence, the effort to join imposed enormous discipline on macroeconomic policies. And this was appreciated by the markets. It was discounted by the market prices. 10-year bonds spread to almost zero. After all, it no longer mattered who issued 10-year bonds. It would pay in euros. And the value of the euro in 10 years' time would be a function of the overall inflation in EMU and the euro exchange rate. It would not be a function of the economics of the particular country that issued the bond. The possibility that that particular country may not be able to pay in 10 years' time was unimaginable. It was not in market prices. Country risk was not priced. And not only credit risk, but also issues of competitiveness and debt sustainability were ignored at that time. The enthusiasm and the easy money covered up all other issues. Yet, it was exactly those low interest rates that led to credit expansion in both the public and the private sector in many European countries. The absence of an exchange rate between countries also led to mispricing. Southern economies lost competitiveness. There was no market pressure to reform. Imbalances built up. By 2009, two major imbalances between core countries and periphery countries appeared. Competitiveness, which showed up in the current account deficits, and fiscal deficits. and Greece was an outlier in both, followed by Portugal. Spain and Ireland, I talk about them because they became program countries, were fiscally prudent, but their private sectors had borrowed a lot. The private sectors created banking problems, their real estate markets created banking problems, and this became a state sector problem once the states moved in to save the banks. And when the international crisis hit in 2007 and 8, the European policy system was largely unprepared. Euro area did not have mechanisms to respond to the crisis. Europe simply followed the coordinated action of the G20. The US, since you live here, you're aware of what happened in the US, proved to be a lot more aggressive in its response to the crisis, both the government and its central bank. In Europe, we didn't observe this. There was sluggishness. Recall, after all, that the ECB had even raised interest rates early on in the crisis. Now, Europeans continued to be sluggish to their response even after the Greek crisis broke out in late 2009. In addressing the crisis, EMU policies were continuously behind the curve. If you read the financial press, you would read about this story, again behind the curve, again behind the curve. This is because Europeans were awakened to the faults of the design of the Eurozone. And instead of addressing the crisis by expansionary fiscal policy and a generous debt write-off policy, they worried about moral hazard. They realized they could not follow an expansionary policy because they would create copycats. Creditor countries in particular became occupied with issues of moral hazard and one-way transfers. Thus, Europe followed a strategy to contain the crisis but not to extinguish it, just simply buy time in order to put in place a more stable architecture. This strategy caused delays and often backfired. I just want to remind you the Deauville-Merkel-Sarkozy statement, I believe it was in October 2010, that in the future, the private sector is going to participate in sovereign defaults. That created enormous turmoil in the market. I remember it very vividly because I used to be a chief economist in a bank back then, and we had access to the wholesale market, and forget it after that. The market disappeared. Now, looking back some years later, were Europeans successful? I told you about how sluggish they were. I told you about the emphasis on building an architecture 15 years too late. When looking at the macroeconomic results over the last 5 or 6 years, and we compare those results with the US, the answer is definitely no. The crisis response has not delivered, if you look at it from a macro perspective. Why? GDP has not grown in Europe since 2008. Compare this with the US. Unemployment, from 7.5% in 2007, was 11.6% in 2014. Compare this with the US. And inflation declined and even became negative without the ECB being super aggressive. In fact, if you look at the numbers, and economists have done that, from 2011 to 2013, fiscal policy was pro-cyclical. What do we mean by that? Instead of throwing money into the economy to be boosted, they were taking money out and were creating a worse economy. Some internal adjustment did proceed. Current account deficits in the periphery countries were erased. However, current account surpluses continued in Germany and the Netherlands. The adjustment was not symmetric. And relative wage and price adjustments between the three large countries, Germany, France, and Italy, marginally changed. There was no mechanism to address these divergences. And what about the EMU architecture? Has it proceeded in a satisfactory fashion? We just said that the Europeans decided to worry about the architecture and forget about the macro picture and the short term. Was the sacrifice of abandoning this prudent counter-cyclical macro policy worth it? I'd say a lot took place in strengthening the EU surveillance mechanism. It's gone with different names, the six-pack, the two-pack, the Europlus, the fiscal compact. A summary of what Europeans did and what they think they ought to do in the future is actually contained in a very nice short report by the five presidents. It's called Completing Europe's Economic and Monetary Union. Now, here is not the place, and I don't think I have the time to address all the details of that report, but let me say that it does target all four aspects to the monetary union that are very important: the economic union, the financial union, the fiscal union, and its democratic legitimacy, which is more at heart with the political scientists. The ultimate aim is to achieve similar resilient economic structures until the year 2025. Now, again, I would need hours and hours to discuss these topics. I'm just going to tell you my own response and feeling the way I saw the report. The things I liked. Anyway, since I told you I'm optimistic, I have to emphasize the things I liked. Well, for the first time, finally, there is discussion about the so-called fiscal stance. What does this mean? Fiscal stance means, are you pushing more money from the state sector into the economy, or you're taking money away? Are you spending more or less? This is important for an EMU-wide fiscal policy. It's needed. If one compares the EMU with the US, the absence of a common or coordinated fiscal policy in EMU is obvious. And not only that, so EMU doesn't have a fiscal policy at an aggregate level as a union. Not only that, its monetary policy only targets inflation, whereas the Fed targets both inflation and unemployment. Therefore, it looks into the real sector. So nobody at the EMU worries about the ups and downs of the cycle and the real sector. And now, for the first time, finally, people are saying, hey, we're going to put it on the table. We need to fix that. And it doesn't mean transfers necessarily, so we don't need to aggravate the creditors. Now, a second element that I found encouraging in that report was that there was a discussion of deeper integration of labor markets. Now, there's a lot being said about labor markets, about open borders and this and that. Reality is very different. You do have an integrated labor market if you're a European citizen. Say you're in Greece, and 10 years down the line, you want to move and live in Italy, and 10 years later, you're going to go to Belgium. You shouldn't have to worry about different labor laws, about your pension benefits, or about your health benefits. That's what true labor mobility means, that you have to fix similar structures across the countries. In fact, I would say you need something even more. If I were a politician with power, I would insist, try to persuade my colleagues, that in school you ought to make the kids learn three more languages, European language, besides the native language, because you need also cultural unification. And cultural unification starts with languages, starts with real mobility. And this way, Europe can be unified from the grassroots if people actually have the ability and move around, and they are indeed unified. Now, there are other nice things in that report. There is the effort to fix the macroeconomic imbalances by creating competitiveness authorities. And there is also something that Europe has been successful, and it was the result of the crisis, that we do have a more realistic fiscal financial union. You know, there is a true banking union unfolding. Now they're talking about a true capital markets union, where the small, medium enterprises can benefit from it. and we are talking about a true deposit insurance, where the fund is a deposit insurance for all Europeans. It's not simply 19 different deposit insurance schemes in different countries, but it's something that's supported by the whole of Europe. Now, again, there's always the element of the creditor countries thinking that somebody's grabbing their pocket and their money. They have invented as a compromise this concept of reinsurance. It's all going to be bank money. Now, there's also a bridge financing of the single resolution mechanism. I don't want to get into the technical details. I'll tell you a couple of things that worried me, though. Two, 3 years ago, at the peak of the crisis, I think the Europeans were a lot more gung-ho about integration. They were talking about a common unemployment insurance that does mean transfers from one country to another, a country that has low unemployment to a country that has hit and has high unemployment. That's not being discussed in the report. They were quite talking about common debt issuance, and that is some kind of a transfer of credibility. But so, let me come back to the question, will the euro area survive? I told you that Europeans are struggling. They responded to the crisis. They thought about the architecture. There is this big struggle between the creditor countries and the debtor countries. My hunch is it will survive as long as it adapts. The Great Recession was not easy to overcome. The Greek crisis was even more difficult. EMU became a better union because of the two crises. At present, and it was discussed earlier, there's a refugee crisis that threatens to open more cracks among the countries, not only of the monetary union, but of the European Union. We have to wait and see. In the short term, the responses are not very good. As you know, tonight the ministers are meeting and they're talking about a qualified majority in their decisions. Europeans try to build unanimity. Whenever you see qualified majority, some people don't like it, they don't believe in it. But anyway. Now I want to come to the second question, which is more closer to my experience, which I posed in the beginning, and this is, will Greece be an EMU member 10 years down the line? My answer here tends to be optimistic, yet I have strong doubts. Maybe not so strong. We'll have to wait and see. Since February, Greece has caught the international media attention thanks to the haphazard behavior of its new leaders. It came very close to Grexit, but eventually chose the path of staying inside the euro area. From 2009, when the Greek crisis erupted, to 2014, Greece actually cured most of its economic imbalances. Yet the anger and the stress of the population found release in voting for the extreme left. The Syriza party, that used to be a marginal party of 3%, rose to power, but was unprepared to govern. 2015 is the year that brought Greece back to recession after it had stabilized. Yet it is also the year that may have taken the political risk away, because the political risk was always there, that an untested new government may push the country outside the EMU. It did not happen, and the very radical left opposition within the Syriza split off, it was marginalized, and even lost out in the elections, didn't enter the parliament. Now, the third MOU that the new government has signed is the last offer the lenders are giving to the Greeks. Will the new government change course and deliver on what it signed? And will it deliver on time? It is a prerequisite for being able to remain in the euro area. We will know in a few months. If you're optimistic and you say, if you're like Papa, like the way it was discussed before, if Greeks always act like Papandreou, maybe, yes, we will deliver. But anyway, what I plan to do in the rest of the time is to give you a more detailed analysis of what happened over the last year or so. And before I do that, as a proper ex-politician, I'm an academic, actually, I'm not a politician. I used to watch the politicians, but I still, there are some things that bother me that are all over the media. They're in the Financial Times, in the Wall Street Journal, especially in the German press. Many, many misperceptions about Greece. One has to understand those misperceptions to put this issue in the right context. And so I'm going to list a bunch of myths the way I thought about them and tell you why they're wrong. Myth number one, Greece used faulty statistical data to enter EMU. Everybody believes that. It's not true. There was an accounting change that took place in 2004. Three, 4 years after Greece had already entered the monetary union, in the way military expenditure is recorded on the budget. This accounting change, if you go back and revise the statistics, showed that in 1999, when Greece was examined, should it enter the monetary union or should it not enter the monetary union, actually inflated the deficit from 2.2% of GDP to 3.1%. To make you understand what this is all about, it's like, suppose the current US government comes and tells you the marginal tax rate is 60%. It's not, it's 32% what it is now. It's 32. And I'm gonna go back 5 years' time, I'm gonna make it 60% 5 years ago. Okay, fine. I come and IRS comes and examines you. He said, my God, you haven't paid your taxes. I'll take you to prison. Well, this myth has taken Greece to prison because it's an exposed decision that there's no way anybody can do anything about it. Myth number two, which is related to myth number one, it became popularized in a book. The Goldman Sachs interest rate swap reduced the size of debt, helping Greece enter EMU by showing a lower debt-to-GDP ratio. It couldn't be far from the truth. Yes, it happened. The swap took place. But it took place in 2001. We were already in the monetary union. And these types of swaps were done back then. They were not considered malevolent. I mean, I was there. I was advising the prime minister. I told him, oh my God, what the finance minister do? But there was no more risk. I mean, well, essentially it was a swap from yen into euros. We wanted to get rid of the exchange rate risk. And with it, they did something to make the debt look smaller. But it was afterwards. Myth number three. Greece was the first country to violate the Stability and Growth Pact. Remember, it's the Holy Grail of Europeans? No, it was the French and the German government that did it. I shouldn't go into the details, I don't want to spend time. On paper, they haven't violated, but in reality, they did it. I mean, on paper, they managed to say that it is legal to suspend the excessive deficit procedure. But in reality, they essentially told the rest of Europe that the rules are for the small and the weak, and they are not for the large and the strong countries. That's what they told them back then. Myth number four, Greece did not achieve much regarding structural reforms implementation under the first and the second bailout program. This is being repeated on and on again and again. Yet the progress made until the end of 2014 on structural reform implementation was remarkable by international standards. And I'm just gonna quote you some, the World Bank of Doing Business, which is the index I really trust. You can compare countries. It's a more objective index. Greece moved from 100th position to the 61st position within those 4 years, 5 years, from 2009 to 2014. And if you look at the OECD indicators of who is better performing who in reforms, Greece was ranked number one every year from 2010 to 2013 as the number one in promoting reforms. However, the reforms that were implemented, somehow they have failed to create the necessary mass that will permit the country to return to sustainable growth. The new program that the country has signed recently has more reforms. Reforms have to be owned by the people. There's definitely a huge need for more push in that direction. Myth number five. Greece did not achieve much in fiscal consolidation. Actually, this is not really a myth, but I put it there just to fill in the gaps. There was an enormous fiscal consolidation all the way to 2014. The general, the government budget back in 2009 was 15.3% of GDP. Think of a country which the revenues are 80 billion and the expenses were like 120 almost. No, the revenues are 85. 35, it was unbelievable, the gap between how much you received and how much you spent. And that shrunk to 3.5% in 2014. When I put the budget in Parliament back in November, I had a zero fiscal deficit for 2015. Had Greece followed the right path, I'm a bit political now, Greece and Germany would be the only countries in Europe with a zero deficit in 2015. This is the holy grail of Mr. Schäuble, by the way. Finally, he's delivering zero deficit in Germany. Anyway, so there is a huge amount of consolidation. By any comparison, and it's exactly what caused the huge recession we observed. Let me move on. Myth number six, public debt was unsustainable at the end of 2014. I mention this because a lot of serious economists, even in this institution, claim that the debt was unsustainable. No, it was sustainable. Had Greece started growing the way it started in 2014, kept growing at 3% in 2015 and so forth, the debt-to-GDP ratio will go down to 110% by 2022. In fact, if you look at the serviceability of debt, it used to cost like 6-7 percentage points of GDP 5 years ago, and it's only 3.5 percentage points of GDP now. Okay. The average maturity of debt increased from 6 years to 17 years. A lot of things were done on this debt. So if you just look at the size of nominal debt, it doesn't give you the right picture. You have to look at the serviceability. The debt was sustainable. It became unsustainable after the new government came to power in February, after it lost credibility, it created fear, it brought the recession back, and therefore the projections about the future are pessimistic. And there was a new need for more cash. Myth number seven. There was no investment interest in Greece, a country to avoid. The answer is true. Investment shrunk. It used to be at the level of 26% back in 2007, 26.6. It went down to 12%. Now, that's not the rate that you ought to observe in a developing country. Now, the U.S. may have an investment GDP ratio of 13, 14%, but it's already a developed country, you expect it. A country that needs to grow has to invest its resources, its ability to produce in the future. Investors did come back in Greece in 2014. I want to remind you that the Greek banks were recapitalized in 2014 with fresh new capital by foreigners primarily. Myth number eight. Grexit will improve the prospects of the Greek economy in the medium term. Grexit and the reintroduction of a new national currency is not among the viable options for the return of the Greek economy to a sustainable growth path. Even if we don't worry about the fact that it's just going to be impossible for the Greeks to fix a new currency overnight, it's going to be a mess, it's going to take them forever, but forget about that. Already we had the internal devaluation. We don't need external devaluation, so it's useless. The external devaluation would only bring inflation. There's no gain on Greek exports from that. We have experience. Successive devaluations in the 80s only brought inflation in Greece. They didn't bring competitiveness, only for a quarter or two. And recent studies have shown that you need to reform the country if you want to export and become competitive. Forget about these macro gimmicks of playing with simply the exchange rate. We as Greeks have to fix our country and not look for some magic things like the exchange rate to do it for us. And if we devalue the currency, is the debt going to be less burdensome? No. Because it's going to be in drachmas, it's going to multiply, and it's all under the British law. We cannot say, gee, I'm not going to pay anymore. Anyway, myth number nine, now I'm coming to the more interesting stuff that you hear in populist press. Greeks are lazy people. We give them free money and they live off our sweat and our hard work. Nobody talks in Europe about these are loans to Greece, they're just giveaways. Well, this is far from the truth. Maybe the public sector is inefficient, people don't work there. But I tell you, in countries where the public sector does not work, it's the private sector that works twice as much. Okay. If you look at the number of hours worked at the OECD publishes, the Greeks worked in highest number of hours among the EU 28. So this is a myth. Other myths like Greeks are wealthy because they don't pay their taxes. Again, oh, that's popular in the US, those Greeks that don't pay their taxes immediately. Well, 36% of the labor force in Greece is self-employed. Who is able to avoid the IRS? It's not going to be the pensioner or the wage earner, it's going to be the guy or the girl that has his own company. It's the self-employed are only 15% in the monetary union. It's 36% in Greece. Of course you're going to see more Greeks not paying their taxes because you've got more of those little guys who can cheat. They have the opportunity to do it. Now, okay, that this is not, of course, a justification. We've got to fix it. We need to do it. And a final myth, not to bore you. Greeks are in a constant turmoil. We're sick and tired about reading Greece in the press. Well, I tell you, given the unprecedented size of the contraction, which is bigger than what here in this country is called the Great Depression, the population's reactions are very controlled. Very decent. The only release valve was the voting for the far left. I remember when there was this huge pension reform back in 2010. I compared it with the pension reform of 2001. Back in 2001, I had advised the then prime minister, don't do it, it's a gimmick, it's a Mickey Mouse reform. Apparently, politically, it was not a Mickey Mouse reform because 600,000 people came out on the streets. The labor unions were against him. Essentially, he lost political power. He was a decent man. He lost it out. 2010, there is a true reform, at least on paper. I remember I wanted to know what was the reaction. I counted all the demonstrations. The largest possible demonstration that was gathered was 60,000 people instead of 600,000 people. One-tenth the demonstration size for a reform that was 10 times as strict. The population had matured. They understood you had to reform. And I think the politicians have failed us thus far for not training the the population of the need for reforms. Now I'll come to some quick questions to give you a complete picture. Why did we have such a huge recession until 2004? I already told you, bigger, larger than the Great Depression in Greece. I mean, there are lots of misperception, but there is a reality, and this is a reality. The loss in income. Every family is feeling it. Either your kid cannot find a job, the unemployment rate is over 50%, or your spouse has lost her job or his job, or your own income, of course, has shrunk, and you may live off your savings. So this is not a myth. How come? What's the problem? Are Greeks special? I mean, if you hear the European politics, and Europe wanted to sort of put Greece in a corner, if it wanted to fix the framework and forget the macro issue, and it would say, oh, it's a special case. Forget about Greece, it's a special case. Well, yeah, initial macroeconomic imbalances were worse than elsewhere in the euro area back in 2009. So a lot worse in Greece than in Portugal or in Spain or in Ireland or what have you. So in there or in Cyprus. So the it was natural that you needed to follow a more restrictive policy. The fiscal policy was all more restrictive. The structure also of the economy is a lot different. It's a more closed economy than the rest of Europe. So the export sector couldn't really carry growth. You had a bit shrinkage of the domestic sector, and the export sector was too small to push forward. And activities dominated by small firms. Small firms didn't have this capacity to look abroad and sell. We have an inefficient public administration, a legacy of unstable tax policies, major bureaucratic hurdles in doing business, lack of level playing field, closed professions, lack of flexibility, lots of these things that need to be fixed. And of course, there were program errors. You know, there's a big blame game being thrown around as to who is responsible for this Great Depression in Greece. And whose fault is it? I'd say it's mostly a domestic politician's fault, but the lenders also have a part of the blame. The domestic politicians, I mean, they lacked the consensus. In Portugal, for example, the center-right and the center-left got together, they agreed on a program, they finished it. In Greece, if you were in the opposition, you used to raise hell and create a mess. The politicians never got together on a common program. On the lender side, I always thought that the recipe suffered from the wrong sequencing of reforms. They tackled the labor market first instead of tackling the product markets. I thought the opposite should happen. And I don't say it exposed, okay? I had written about it back in 2007 before anybody had a smell, understood what was going on. So Greece had, there were many special circumstances, its beginnings and its structure and the errors that made the recession huge. Now, what about the state of play before my government lost power? I'd say it. I have to praise my house, otherwise it's gonna fall and destroy me. But it's true. At the end of 2014, the worst seemed to be over. The country was close to a major takeoff. The imbalances were cured. We didn't have a current account deficit. We started from a current account deficit of 14% of GDP. We couldn't sell to, we kept importing but not exporting. Now we had an imbalance. We were exporting as much as we were importing. We were even exporting more. The fiscal issue, we had primary surpluses. Economic growth had resumed, at least 0.8%. Investment finally had turned positive. It was not negative anymore. Investors were flocking in. Privatizations had started. We had sold, I remember, the regional airports for 3 times the price we had expected. And then the new government came in and froze it. It was crazy. They don't understand that when you privatize something, you don't give it away. The port of Piraeus is not gonna walk away and go to Shanghai, and China is gonna grab it. It's there. They utilize the resources. Back then, growth was expected at 3%. The balance I told you was balanced. And we were about to leave the memorandum. We were finishing. And we were going to go into a credit line, the so-called ECCL. And the money was there, too. And the debt was on a sustainable path. In fact, in November of 2014, at the Eurogroup, Mr. Moscovici came out and said, Greece has done more than enough to close the review. This is the second program, the final thing. And a lot more than any other program country, including Cyprus, Portugal, Ireland, whoever was a program country up to that point. It was the IMF, on the other hand, that disagreed. They smelled political disaster. They knew we would be over. They wanted us to front-load the 2015 reforms early on, before the elections. Come on, this is politically crazy. Even a non-politician like me could understand it. And they could have closed the review and actually said, okay, I'm going to give you the money bit by bit. This way, the new government that came to power would have been forced to line up early on, and we wouldn't have had this recession. But anyway, this is the story of 2014. What went wrong since February? How come we're again the media attention? Well, lots of things went wrong. You had a new government which wasted precious time and didn't understand that time was running against it. It brought the economy back to stagnation, if not recession. It was inexperienced and lacked work ethic. Lacked work ethic. You called my ministry at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, nobody would pick up the phone. I had no Saturday or Sunday, I used to leave at 11. The ministers were unleashed on TV and did something very strange for the political ethics. They kept after they won the election, they kept promising even more. Usually, before the elections, you promise 10, you deliver 2 or 3, and you try to avoid it and say, okay, maybe later. These guys had no idea what they were doing. They were full of illusions about the economy. No sense of how value added gets created, and they had a genuine dislike of the private sector. They ignored the supply side of the economy, thinking it has a momentum of its own and their own behavior does not affect it. This is really the inheritance of the ex-Soviet Union. The capitalist system exists. It has its own laws, somehow irrefutable, whatever it's called. You have to read Marx. I've forgotten about it. And you sit there and you just grab the money and you redistribute it. No, what you say and what you do affects the value chain. And you better be part of this creation of value. They didn't understand it. They claimed the previous MOUs were responsible for the economy's fate. And they would negotiate to alter them. In fact, they wanted to win the past war 5 years earlier. So they said, we're going to have a nominal debt haircut. Come on. The debt now was owned by other European citizens. Why would a Slovakian or a Belgian accept, instead of being paid 100 for the 100 loan that he gave you, to get paid 70 or 60? Why? Just because you got voted and you're the new left, it doesn't mean that the other politicians don't face their own citizens. Why would the other citizens accept a nominal debt haircut? This was crazy altogether. And they adopted a very aggressive strategy vis-a-vis the Europeans based on the perception I told you earlier that EMU instability gets generated from Grexit alone, not from moral hazard. What do I mean by that? if you think about the European, the way Europe was observing the new government, they had two opposite policies to follow. Am I lenient? And okay, the heck with them. Greece is only 2% of EMU. Just erase it, get out of the way, and we solve it. No, it creates copycats. What if Italians come later? I mean, they're not going to accept, or somebody else comes. That's moral hazard. You cannot do it. Now, am I super strict and I kick them out? Maybe the Eurozone would unravel. Well, Syriza only overplayed the kicking out card, the unraveling of the Eurozone. They didn't understand that the opposite was also a constraint. So instead of trying to get into the, if you're really to understand game theory, because some people claim they were game theorists, they were not. You try to understand the maximization problem of the other side and say, how flexible are they? And within that, those parameters of flexibility, you try to push them in the area that maximizes your benefit. That's what they should have done. They didn't. They said, we're a new leftist government. You did force to us. You did this and that. And you're going to come to us. We're not going to try to maximize your benefit. And of course, they failed. What this did, of course, is create, I mean, Greeks are not stupid. I mean, their politicians may act in a stupid way, but the population really were fearful of them. They may have voted for them, but you've got to watch the Greeks, what they do. And they pulled out their money from the banks. 25% of the deposits were gone. So the deadline of June 30th passed, and the PM was trapped himself into a corner with no friends. He was close. He finally decided he realized he was going to exit Greece. He realized the danger, and he was coming close to a deal of 9 billion euros worth of measures. I want to compare this with the 1 billion I had already agreed with the Europeans back in November. 9 this time, 1 the previous. But he had an internal problem with his party. He had lots of crazies in his party. They believed it, that the Europeans were at fault. So he had a referendum. That, of course, the referendum created bank panic because everybody said, oh my God, now it's Grexit. So before Monday, the banks were closed. Of course, Syriza said it's the Europeans that closed our banks. It's not our actions, it's the Europeans, somebody else's. That's a typical problem. Then the prime minister, of course, within 5 days, he did exactly the opposite of what the referendum said. He signed the deal. He signed a worse deal than 3 weeks ago, earlier. It was 10 times worse. It was a political upheaval within Syriza. The leftists were split. We went to elections, et cetera, and the rest is history. You know it. What's the current state of affairs? Economic activity is still resilient. But we expect a recession by year end because of capital controls. The earliest expansion we're going to see perhaps is the Q3 of 2016 in the summer. The debt is no longer sustainable. Now something has to be done on the debt. Now the Syriza will claim, by God, they won a compromise, but they haven't won anything because all that stuff we had proposed anyway. Economic sentiment is very low. If you follow the economic news, you know the universal PMI index has to be above 50. In Greece, it's like a record low, below 40. There's a new program now that was signed. The Europeans realized and they gave Greece another chance of 3 years. It has 3 years now to enter the market. And the major challenges are is a timely completion of the bank recapitalization. The banks have to be recapitalized again. After the foreigners came in with their money, now the banks have to be recapitalized again. That's a big problem, because if they completely lose their money, then we're going to be looking with a telescope foreign investors for a number of years. The new program does include about 220 structural reforms and actions. A lot of them, they're front-loaded. They have to be done quickly. So now I'm coming to the penultimate question. Can growth come back? And therefore say that we simply had a 2-year delay. with all as to what had happened? Or are we heading for Grexit and a further drastic reduction in living standards? Well, it's hard to say. The first 3 months will reveal whether the government has changed for the better or not. We will know by tomorrow the people in the government. If they are the same, then I'll be worried. Structural reforms have to be implemented on pensions, on labor market, on public administrations. A lot of them touch CIRSD's clientele groups. Will they finally get over it and actually think about the country and not the clientele groups? It's tough for politicians to do it. My experience there as a finance minister, I spend a lot of my time trying to block the ministers of the parties I represented for undoing the reforms they had signed 6 months earlier. I mean, it's a constant struggle. And unless the reforms are owned by the people, and ownership does not come by virgin birth, they have to be educated, reforms can be taken away very quickly. So structural reforms have to be pushed. A renewed focus on structural reforms can boost growth, but the prime minister has to understand that those reforms are actually a socialist policy if he realizes it, that transparency, that a level playing field, that fighting oligopolies and monopolies, opening up professions. My God, these are the things you were always fighting for. You never understood it. Think about it. Somebody has to train the guy. Credibility has to be reestablished slowly. It's not going to come overnight. There is liquidity out there. There are the structural funds. There is the Juncker plan. There is the new cash that will come for bank recapitalization. So liquidity is out there. It can be grabbed. For the future, you have to have higher private investment and exports. These are the keys. The economics of the country and its EMU fate is on the hands of politicians. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you so much. We have a few minutes left for the formal part of discussion, and then all of you are invited to the reception next door where we can talk informally. You made a very convincing case that the Greek leadership over the last several months made a lot of mistakes, were not really trained in understanding the world around them. But, you know, you could call them crazy in many ways. They reversed the course in very dramatic fashion and did precisely something which they promised never to do. And nevertheless, the Greek population voted them back in office. I mean, so are only the left-wing politicians crazy, or there is something wrong going on with the entire nation? What would you say to that?
No, I think I received an email last night telling me, my God, Gikas, you were telling it that they're going to give him a second chance a month ago. Yeah, the population vote, they're sick and tired of all politicians. A lot of people are feeling the recession, are feeling it in their families, and they blame the old political system. So here you have a young fellow. I mean, he may have screwed up in the five, 6 months. You don't really understand what is going on with Europe. I mean, you have a vague notion. You don't really, I can tell he's screwing up, but the population can't. So they just see some guy, okay, he's telling, give me another chance, I didn't really have time. Yes, I made some mistakes, but you're gonna go with the old? Come on, with the new. So they were persuaded.
Where is Greek press? Where are journalists? Where is television? I mean, you know, this is the infrastructure of democracy, which is supposed to, you know, tell people what they should believe in,
right,
and what's right, what's
the
wrong.
The infrastructure of democracy in a capitalist system, and the press is too dependent on Syriza. They threatened to reallocate the frequencies in the airwaves, so they were afraid to criticize them. and a lot of them had had borrowed from banks, and the banks are more or less state-controlled. So against Syriza was on top of them. It was amazing how quickly the press was pro-Syriza. You would like only 10 or 15% were objective, I would count.
All right, we have big issues. The Euro crisis, the Greek crisis, the recent elections. Who would like to jump in into the discussion? Peter Hall, please introduce yourself before asking.
I'm Peter Hall. I'm a teacher in the government department. I wanted to take up your comment about Greece's economic performance, its small export sector, a closed economy, and ask you if you could look farther ahead into the future, that is, say, a decade into the future, 20 years into the future, can you say something about on what basis you think Greece could grow successfully? And Greece grew actually quite rapidly in the opening decade of the euro, but of course some would argue that that was based on borrowed money and borrowed time. Professor Hausman at the Kennedy School here, you'll be on a panel with him tomorrow, has argued, as I'm sure you know, that given the composition of Greek exports, heavily agricultural, not so many high value-added exports, that the basis for long-term prosperity in the country doesn't really exist. And so we have a crisis at the moment, but I'd very much like to know what you think the basis for a long-term growth strategy might be. Thank you.
This is a very, very deep question indeed. I think the educational level of the people is quite high. And you do have, right now, a lot of companies involved in IT, even coming to the US, a lot of pharmaceuticals, a lot of agricultural products. I mean, the reason you didn't see it in the past is because business people didn't have to travel abroad, didn't have to think to sell to foreigners because there was a huge domestic demand. Money was easy, it was borrowed money. People were living off borrowed money. And so businesses adjusted to that. I mean, I think the business sector will adjust. I mean, in a capitalist system, you can never predict and you cannot really say, I'm going to push this sector versus the other sector. I mean, you try some things. But I think the moment the bureaucracy gets wiped out, Greeks can really excel because they work very hard, believe me. I know it. I worked in the U.S. You know, I made tenure in the U.S. and I went to Greece. My God, I worked a lot harder to stay at the same level I was in the U.S. with half the work. So Greeks do work hard. You just need to fix the environment. If you fix the environment, it can be done. And looking at the value-added content of exports of the previous 5 years is not a good predictor and a good indicator. I can see Ricardo's problem, but it's not a good indicator of what will happen.
Mm-hmm. Yes, Sebastian.
Thank you. I'm Sebastian Royo. I'm a professor of government at Suffolk University. And I'm originally from Spain, and when I was listening to a lot of what you were saying, I could replace Greece for Spain, and things wouldn't be very different. And whenever I give presentations, I spend a lot of time trying to explain the misconceptions about what happened and who was responsible for what happened. But the risk when we do that is that in some ways we're minimizing what brought us to this situation. There were serious structural problems in both countries. There were a lot of policy mistakes that led to the crisis. And they need to be addressed. So I wonder if, I mean, your reflection gave us a much more nuanced view of what had happened in Greece, but in some ways it can lead to minimize the responsibility of the politicians and the governments that brought the country to this situation. And so what can we learn from what happened prior to the crisis so that we don't repeat it again? And blaming others like we tend to do in our country, it's just not gonna fix it.
Well Spain didn't have a fiscal problem. I mean, they had deficits lower than the German deficits. You know, back in 2008, 2009, 2010, it became popular that the Eurozone crisis was a fiscal crisis. It was not. I mean, Spain went to a crisis, and it was more fiscally prudent than Germany. Spain had let its banks failed it in its real estate market, and through its banks had a problem, and also had a competitiveness problem. It couldn't sell abroad as much as it was importing. So the competitiveness problem was there for Spain. I think it's fixing it. The export sector in Spain is doing quite well now, a lot better than the Greek one. It's a lot bigger also. The two problems that the crisis brought up was the fiscal and the competitiveness. And the euro area and its design, now it's trying, it focused a lot on the fiscal, now it's focusing in this report, of the five presidents' report, also on the competitiveness issue. And other things that I mentioned, having a fiscal policy at the Eurozone level, et cetera, et cetera. Mm-hmm. Yes, please.
My name is Siegfried Weichlein. I'm a visiting fellow at the center, and I'm a professor for contemporary history in Fribourg in Switzerland. Parts of your talk could be understood as if you were up for election. So you were talking very much about Greek economics, Greek politics, and particularly the present government. I was wondering, how does Europe come into this picture, the future of Europe, what Grzegorz talked about? Does it come into the picture as the money supply side, as the way how to finance the mess, whatever the reasons for that mess were? Or are there, I would be interested particularly in that, are there characteristics of the crisis in Greece that can be generalized on the southern flank of Europe, Portugal, Spain, parts of Italy, Cyprus. So on the crisis side, are there parts of or developments that led to the Greek crisis that you would also see in other parts of southern Europe? Or is Europe just part of the money supply side?
Well, since you need unanimity for a lot of things, I mean, whatever happens to one country affects every other country. The problems that Greece faced, the fact that it has to make its pension system sustainable, stable, self-financed, all countries have to do the same thing. The fact that Greece has to minimize bureaucracy, all countries have to do the same thing. Greece is a small example of what went wrong, perhaps, and what is being fixed. It's not just the money supply. I mean, when you talk about the money supply, this is actually another problem where I guess political scientists ought to discuss this. How come? Here you have the Europeans dishing out, especially around 180 billion of loans, and now another 80, whatever. I don't know if you can add them up, but a lot of money to Greece. So Greece doesn't suffer a sudden stop, whatever a lot of South American economies had suffered once. And so that Greece buys the time to fix itself up. The Europeans did this. Somehow, the Greek population never understood it. The Greek politicians managed to say, oh, I'm doing this reform not because we have to do it because it's good for you. It's because the Europeans are telling us to do it. So they turned the population against the foreigners who helped them. So that's why reforms and flexibility in the various countries is very important for the monetary union to survive. I remember about 20 years ago, I was there involved when the ECB rules were put up. And I remember I was surprised then as an economist that nobody was talking about reforms and flexibility and how are we going to fix those economies. It was all forgotten. And I said, my God, there's something wrong now. Politics is so important in Europe. Now, when I joined the Eurogroup, all they talk about is reforms. Now they finally understood it. Of course, a crisis had to hit their economies before they understood it. But I think whatever happened to Greece, it happened in an extreme version. It happened to other countries. The other countries, they managed their politics better. They got out more quickly. We got stuck. Now I'd say, now we're going through having to essentially train the left of the right thing to do and have them understand that reforms is to their benefit. So it's not about money supply. It's about understanding of how you really fix the structure of the economy.
Sophia.
Yes, my name is Sophia Perez, and I'm a political scientist at Boston University and affiliated with the Center for European Studies here. I want to ask you a question that might sound technical, but I think it's very relevant. In July of 2012, the lead economist at the IMF came out with a paper that said that in pushing for fiscal consolidation and reforms, there had been a mistake in estimating the multiplier effect of that fiscal consolidation, and that it had too much fiscal consolidation had been pushed too fast, in essence, and that had hurt growth. I wonder if you can tell us what you think about that study and its significance.
Yeah. It was Olivier Blanchard. Yeah, he used to be here when I was an undergraduate. It's true the IMF had underestimated the multiplier. However, when that study came out, you know what my interpretation was back then? Oh, my God. The IMF wants to take the blame to make the Europeans admit it finally that they overdid it on Greece. They were too strict. Actually, when the IMF came to Greece in 2010, they were the soft guys. They had experience with countries in trouble, and they knew that if you push too much consolidation immediately, you may generate the opposite effect because the population will resist it. And they were the soft people. The hardest people were the ECB people. And they acted in a very political way, the ECB people. Why? Because they felt the independence of the ECB was threatened. All of a sudden, you had a country that didn't obey the fiscal rules. And my God, what's going on with the politicians? We're going to end up paying the bill because they're going to come to us as the lender of last resort. And they're going to ask us to expand the money supply. And what if we have inflation? Okay. We got lucky, and there was no inflation in the Eurozone. But so back there, the ECB was the toughest. They continue to be the toughest all along. The IMF was the softest. The admittance by Blanchard that maybe we did a mistake, I think he tried to push the Europeans to say, come on, you have overdone it. I was there when the second, with another hat. I was the advisor to the prime minister, the interim prime minister, Mr. Lucas Papadimos. And I was there in the last night when the PSI took place, the haircut on the private debt, and everything was resolved. And this was a big deal. I don't want to get into the details, but I'll tell you this. 4 o'clock in the morning, 5 o'clock in the morning at the Eurogroup, the reason I was there at the Eurogroup is because the prime minister was invited. Usually I was. But I was there. Everybody was congratulating themselves. Finally, they had really brought the discount of the face value from 50 to 46 and a half something. They had done a lot. And finally, they had arranged a package. It would work. I remember Christine Lagarde stood up and said, and I'm not quoting her, but paraphrasing from what I remember, saying, "Come on, ministers," said, "don't congratulate yourselves, because in 3 years' time, you're going to be called to dig your hands into your pockets and give more money to Greece." I couldn't believe it. It just showed that the IMF had not bought the second program. They thought it was too harsh. And that was February. The paper came out in June. So when the paper came out in June, I thought the IMF wanted to tell the Europeans, come on, say it too, you too. Don't screw the Greeks too much. And in fact, in November of that year, the Europeans did give a break to the Greeks. They reduced interest rates. They said, okay, the fiscal surpluses, we're going to postpone them for 2 years. They did give a break, okay? And they managed to finance it. So I interpret this politically also.
You know, Greece has been the focal point of European crisis, and I think this was the right theme to start our summit on Europe with. We are all invited to our discussions tomorrow on a variety of other issues, but please join me to thank Professor Hardouvelis for this enlightening conversation.
Thank you.